Recorded Books presents The Secret Keepers of Old Depot Grocery by Amanda Cox. Narrated by Stephanie Cozart. Chapter 1. Present Day. Sarah nudged aside last night's puddle of clothes with her bare foot, the exposed designer label sticking out a bit too much. At the dresser in her childhood bedroom, she tugged open the drawer that without a doubt was just like she'd left it 12 years ago. The scent of lavender filled her nose. The familiar sight of favorite t-shirts and the sachets Mom tucked into every drawer soothed the ache in Sarah's chest, pain that followed her to her mother's front porch in Brighton, Tennessee. She grabbed a t-shirt and a pair of cut-off shorts from the drawer and slipped them on in place of the borrowed nightshirt she'd been wearing, relieved that the old shorts still zipped and snapped without too much effort. Sarah stood in front of the full-length mirror in the corner and inspected her reflection. The faded Old Depot grocery t-shirt was a little tighter than she'd prefer, but it looked all right. Her gaze traveled downward to the large square bandages her mother had affixed to her knees, covering cuts that she hadn't even registered until Mom pointed out the dried blood last night. The reflection in front of her was something of a time warp, this skinned knee version of herself. If she could forget that the minor injuries to her knees weren't from a failed rollerblading attempt. The aroma of Mom's famous biscuits and gravy drifted under the bedroom door. Sarah's high school throwbacks might fit now, but not for long if Mom started feeding her like this. Sarah padded down the hallway's worn beige carpet and entered the bathroom. She splashed cool water on her face. When she lifted her eyes, seeking the basket of hand towels Mom kept on the shelf beside the sink, Sarah spotted the large Triton seashell from Aaron's and her honeymoon 6 years ago, a gift she'd sent back home to her parents. Sarah held the shell to her ear, listening for the sound of waves. She'd walked that beach, hand in hand with her husband, an ocean of possibilities in front of them. She placed the shell back on the shelf and grabbed the towel. Pressing her face into the terry cloth, she attempted to scrub away the memory. Was it possible to go back and get a redo on life? Pretend there'd never been a reality beyond this rural town and a little girl's dream to play shopkeeper for the rest of her life? Following her nose, Sarah walked to the kitchen. Her mother faced the stove with a gingham apron tied around her waist, piling fluffy biscuits onto a platter. Overhead, Mom's hen collection adorned her cabinet tops, lined up in all shapes and sizes like they marched in a perpetual parade. Sarah smiled. "Morning, Mom. Breakfast smells amazing. You shouldn't have gone to all that trouble, though." Her mother turned and flicked a glance over her, but her expression remained placid, inscrutable. "It's not every day my only daughter shows up for an impromptu visit." Sarah tried and failed to detect the emotion motivating that statement. Whether it was sadness or wariness, Sarah wasn't sure. Though Mom had been roused from a deep sleep when Sarah arrived at 2 in the morning, you wouldn't have been able to tell from the way she'd ushered Sarah inside, cleaned her wounds, and served her a cup of herbal tea before leading Sarah to her old bedroom. Always a hostess, even when the guest was completely unexpected. Or maybe Mom had expected Sarah to come these past 2 weeks, and the fact that it had taken her this long to seek her mother's comfort was the greater surprise. Sarah sat, and her mother poured her a cup of coffee. Once the cream and sugar were stirred in, Sarah took a sip, but the brew she normally found so comforting turned her stomach instead. She set the mug down on the pinewood table with a clunk. "Something wrong with the coffee?" Sarah swallowed back the nausea welling in her throat. She shook her head, afraid to open her mouth. Mom placed a plate of biscuits and gravy in front of each of them. She never took her eyes off her daughter, as if the constant eye contact could pull the answers to unspoken questions from Sarah's lips. "Are your knees feeling okay this morning? Do you think we got out all the bits of glass?" Crystal? Yeah, they feel fine, thanks. Sarah had felt strangely numb while she sat on the fuzzy pink toilet lid cover while Mom had inspected for grit embedded in her skin. An accident, she'd said when Mom asked her what happened. But the shatter of delicate crystal on mahogany floors before she fled the silent house yesterday had been the most cathartic thing she'd experienced in quite some time. The destruction had been intentional, cutting herself on the mess she'd made, not so much. So, Mom took a long drink of her coffee. Sarah picked at the edge of her biscuit, bracing herself for the question that would follow that long pause. Mom set her mug down and dabbed her chin with a napkin. How long do you think you'll stay? She said the words with a gentle smile, but Mom wasn't asking how many days she should expect Sarah's visit to last. She was making sure Sarah knew better than to use her house as a permanent hideaway. When will Dad be back? Mom glanced at the wall calendar as though she didn't have her husband's trucking schedule memorized. He'll be on leave in a week. He's supposed to get his usual 7-day break. Oh, good. I'm looking forward to some quality father-daughter time. Hopefully, that would be enough information to keep her mother from digging any deeper into Sarah's plans. And maybe 2 weeks would be long enough to ease her into the idea of turning the mother and daughter team that ran Old Depot Grocery, the store that had been in their family for decades, into a mother and daughter and granddaughter trio. Sarah never should have left in the first place. When are you headed to the store? Not until closer to noon. Mom massaged her hands. I have a doctor's appointment. Is something wrong? Just a routine checkup. Sarah pushed back from the table and wiped the crumbs from her hands. I'm going to head to Old Depot to spend some time with Nan. Help out if she needs it.
The only help she needs is in seeing reason.
Mom muttered the words behind her mug. What did you say? Sarah grabbed a Tupperware from the cabinet.
Is that all you're going to eat? You're practically a toothpick as it is.
Sorry, I'm feeling a little rocky this morning, is all. Sarah placed her nibbled biscuit in the plastic container for later. Wasting food around her mother's house was not an option. If her mother only knew how many casseroles Sarah had been given that were now untouched and molding in her refrigerator back home, she would have an apoplectic fit.
Maybe you should stay in bed and get some rest.
The last thing Sarah needed was more time alone with her thoughts.
No, I think a day at Old Depot is just what the doctor ordered.
She set her plate in the sink.
Sarah.
Bye, I'll see you later.
Sarah smiled through her forced chipper tone and then grabbed her purse and keys from the hall tree by the front door. She slid her feet into Mom's spare flip-flops. Her mother called out from the kitchen.
We need to talk. The store.
Sarah cut off the words by shutting the door behind her. As she drove, she soaked in the ambiance of her little town. It had this old-fashioned air about it, tucked into the corner of the world, hidden from the effects of passing time. People sitting on their front porches lifted their hands and waved as she passed. Others were already hard at work in their flower beds. Sarah slowed her car for a tractor that was turning off the main road. A few minutes later, she parked in front of the old store, having her choice of spots in the almost empty lot. She took in the familiar sight of the twin gabled storefront. Between the gables, the red-painted sign read, Old Depot Grocery. Sarah let out a long breath that cleansed her, heart and soul. She stood from the car and stepped over the dandelions that were sprouting from cracks in the sidewalk. Dandelions weren't pretty things, but they proved more resilient than roses. The front door burst open, interrupting her musing. Out stumbled a harried man in a suit with a strange little hop in his step. He was followed by Nan, who scowled and jabbed the broom at the fellow, who had already dove into his car and had it cranked and backing out of the lot in no time. Sarah stifled a laugh at the terror her petite grandmother had incited in the large man fleeing her store. Nan jabbed the broom toward the retreating car once more for good measure, yelling,
"And stay out, you miscreant! Old Depot Grocery has never been and will never be for sale."
Chapter 2. June, 1965. Glory Ann trudged down the stairs, the morning light filtering through the east-facing windows, wrapping her in a soft, warm glow. It was a perfect day for the June wedding that would never be. Her mother stood at the bottom of the stairs, massaging her temple.
"Darling, please go change. It's a lovely summer day. That black dress washes all the color out of your face."
The time she'd spent hugging the porcelain commode was the more likely culprit. But Gloria Ann would bear any burden for the privilege of carrying Jimmy's child.
"I'm in mourning."
Who cared if no one wore mourning clothes anymore? It was her way to make sure no one forgot how much he had meant to her. Her mother released a sigh that stooped her shoulders.
"I know you thought you loved him."
And there it was, the real reason she didn't like the way Gloria Ann had been skulking about for a month in that same dress.
"Mother?"
Gloria Ann hoped her tone was enough of a warning. She couldn't have this conversation again. Not after the fallout around the dinner table when she'd finally confessed to her parents the secret she'd kept for weeks. That at 19, she, the minister's daughter, was pregnant.
"Out of wedlock,"
the words Mama said would follow her all the days of her life. She shook her head. The first words out of her father's mouth had been,
"What are we going to do now? You can't have a shotgun wedding with a dead man, Gloria Ann."
As she stood frozen on the stairs, her father appeared at her mother's side with the newspaper in his hand, his reading glasses perched atop his head. His face was lined and gray. The glory of the morning hadn't lightened the burden her father carried any more than it had Gloria Ann's. Her mother pinched the slim bridge of her nose.
"Go change into that nice yellow dress you have, the one with the little white flower sewn into it, please."
It seemed her parents not only wanted her along on their visit with old friends today, but expected her to play the part of the little ray of sunshine, too. They both looked so weary that she complied. Gloria Ann almost always complied. That's why it had been such a shock to her parents that she and Jimmy, the poster children for good Christian raising, had taken things too far. Just that one time, she'd sworn, but she could tell they doubted. But it had been just one time. One moment of tears and fear, sorrow and hopes. His name had been called, and despite his bravado, Jimmy hadn't made it 5 minutes over there. She'd known he wouldn't. Those soulful blue eyes of his were made to behold long rows of thriving crops under a southern sun, not the horrors of Vietnam. In front of the oval mirror, Gloria Ann stripped off the black A-line dress and studied the Irish cream figure that was her reflection. Her hand found the slight curve of her lower belly, the place where a little bit of her and a little bit of Jimmy was growing, a seed of love. Perhaps it shouldn't have been planted, but despite the shame she and her family would suffer, she couldn't bring herself to regret it. After she changed into the cheery dress her mother had requested, Gloria Ann tidied her rogue onyx curls and pinched color into her cheeks. She tucked the letter she never sent into her pocket. If she dared to send it, maybe by some postal miracle, Jimmy would have received it in time and known he was going to be a father before he died. Maybe it would have made a difference, somehow. When she walked out to the car, her father placed a small valise in the trunk.
Mother must be bringing some quilting supplies to the lady of the house.
I'm ready.
At the sound of her voice, he lifted his head, his expression startled.
You look lovely.
She fixed the pretty smile that he expected on her face. There had been enough strain and strife lately. It would be best to make this beautiful early summer day a nice time together. She couldn't undo her choices, but she could make today pleasant. She opened the back door of the tan Cadillac.
Ride up front with me, why don't you?
But Mama...
Your mother went to bed with a headache.
He glanced away.
It'll just be me and you today.
Despite her attempts to stir conversation throughout the drive, her father remained stiff in his seat behind the wheel, offering quiet, one-word replies. Glorianne gave up and stared out the window at the verdant farmland. It sure hadn't been easy confessing what she and Jimmy had done. It was a secret she'd wanted to take to her grave. But some secrets demanded to be revealed. Some secrets grew with time and had a life and a heartbeat of their own. What did Daddy think of her now? Did he love her still? Or was he more concerned with how their tiny community would react when they realized the minister couldn't even keep his own family on the straight and narrow? An hour later, they pulled into a one-stoplight Tennessee town named Brighton. Her father stopped at what looked to have once been a train depot. The weed-infested tracks were long abandoned by rail cars. The sign over the door read, Old Depot Grocery. Her father killed the ignition and leaned his forehead against the steering wheel.
Daddy?
He straightened and offered her a tight-lipped smile.
You ready?
For what? She thought they were going out visiting, not shopping at a small grocery a few towns away.
Clarence Clearwater is a very nice man. His parents were old family friends of mine. This is his store.
Okay. She tilted her head. Why should she give a fig about Clarence Clearwater and Old Depot Grocery? He hesitated, his mouth working as if he intended to say more.
Let's go in and I'll introduce you.
Glorianne exited the car and watched the people coming and going on the sidewalk. The curious look she garnered made it clear that new faces were always noticed in a town like this. Some were shabby farmers in threadbare overalls. Others nicely clothed in store-bought dresses in a similar style to her own. Yet all these people seemed to belong here, like fabric stitched together on a patchwork quilt. She trailed behind her father. What kind of looks would she receive when her pregnancy became obvious? How would her own little town treat her? Always the little darling everyone admired with her songbird voice, delicate figure, and demure manner. Now a fallen woman. She squared her shoulders and lengthened her stride. She'd just have to grow thicker skin, keep her chin up, and dare anyone to say a word with fire in her eyes. Her days as a minister's bashful daughter were over. Once inside, her father approached a man in a green apron. He was probably about 10 years her senior. He had narrow, stooped shoulders and a crooked nose that looked like he'd been punched once or twice and never had it set right. But his too close brown eyes were gentle and kind. Her father inclined his head toward the man, and they shared a quick, whispered conversation.
Come here, Glorianne. I'd like to introduce you. This is Clarence Clearwater.
Glorianne offered her hand. The stranger took it and gave it a soft squeeze, a question in his eyes. He gave a decisive nod, and his gaze locked with her father's.
Sir, I'd be honored to marry your daughter.
The air became stifling and close. Glorianne's vision blurred, and the room seemed to tip.
Strong arms enveloped her, and her world went as black as the dress she'd donned earlier that morning. Light filtered back into her view. Glorianne was cushioned by something soft and musty. Hushed conversation floated in the air with the dust motes. She struggled to sit and found herself lying on a dingy couch in a cramped office lit by a green desk lamp. Her father stood from his chair and knelt beside her.
Honey, are you okay?
He passed her a cup of water, and she took a sip to relieve the cottony feel of her mouth. Her head cleared, and Clarence's words, the moment before she'd fainted, broke through the haze. She gasped.
I don't know what you think you're doing, but I am not. I will not marry that man. You can't make me do this.
Clarence cleared his throat and rose from where he sat at the desk. He gave an awkward sort of bow.
I'll give you two a minute.
Her father grasped her hands.
Glorianne, Clarence is a good man. He's respected in the community, a business owner.
And he wants to be saddled with a pregnant woman who doesn't even want him? What kind of man could he possibly be? The kind no one will have, that's what.
I've known Clarence and his family for years. I wouldn't be willing to do this if they weren't good people.
You wouldn't be willing? What about me? I know I made mistakes, but does that mean I should be punished for life?
Her throat tightened, the disbelief taking her normally lilting voice to a rasping screech. Her father pressed his fingertips to the space between his brows.
I'm not punishing you. I'm trying to help you, help our family. You've put us in a right tight spot, Glorianne.
Her mouth fell open. She was the one whose life was about to be turned upside down by a newborn, whose heart was shattered by loss. She was the one who the town would gossip about and look down on. Was it shame that motivated him to ship her off and tie her to a man she didn't know?
A tight spot?
I could lose the church.
A weight sank in her middle.
The board hasn't been happy. Attendance has been down, and they blame me. Now with you pregnant and no man in sight to claim the child, I fear it'll be what breaks us.
He took her hand, squeezing too tight.
Don't do it for me. Heaven knows I'd find a way to manage. But your mother? She was raised in that church. Think what it would do to her if we were asked to give up our position.
Mother always seemed to have been made of chipped china, and Glorianne understood how little it would take to shatter her. She'd spent her life trying to cushion her mother from the harsh edges of life, turning off the news or hiding a newspaper if the reports were too dark. She pulled her hand out of her father's grip.
So, what? Now I'll be banished from home forever?
You two will marry as soon as we obtain a license, and you'll go on to have a family. Clarence has agreed to raise the child as his own. This child will be loved and cared for, a part of a solid family. If you don't do this for your mother, then think of the child. Think of how he or she will be treated if you don't go through with this.
His eyes were wide, pleading. Her hands trembled, and she clasped them tightly in her lap to make them still.
Can I take some time to think? Get to know Clarence a bit?
The words tasted sour in her mouth. His gaze went to the floor as he shook his head.
There's no time. Rumors will be bad enough as it is.
Glorianne's stomach churned, having nothing to do with the little life growing inside. No wonder her mother hadn't wanted her wearing black that morning. She'd dressed her for her wedding, and Glorianne hadn't even known it.
Mama's not here.
She hated the plaintive sound of her voice, but on her wedding day, her mother was supposed to be at her side, reveling in all the lacy details.
She wanted to be here for you, but she just couldn't bear it. She packed up your hope chest for you.
Her dreams of that someday June wedding had suffered a fatal blow the day she'd heard Jimmy died. This was like heaping dirt on top of a coffin whose occupant was still struggling for breath. 3 days later, in the dim, cramped office, Glory Ann Hawthorne became Mrs. Clarence Clearwater, all to cover up a secret she was not ashamed of. Chapter 3. Present Day. Satisfied she'd successfully run off her intruder, Nan lowered her broom, a scowl marring her aged face. She froze and squinted at the sight of Sarah standing on the sidewalk.
Sarah? Land sakes, is it really you?
Glory Nan. Sarah whispered the nickname the 4-year-old version of herself had dubbed her grandmother with, a mispronunciation of her given name that stuck for life. A full smile dissolved the harsh lines that had been etched in Nan's face moments before, and she opened her arms. Sarah hurried to her and sank into her hug, the haven she'd been craving. After a long moment, Nan pulled back from their embrace and stared into Sarah's eyes like some sort of scanner doing a status check. She released a soft, "Humph."
"I know it's hard, but you'll pull through. You're a Clearwater girl, and Clearwater girls are made of some pretty stout stuff."
Warmth filled Sarah's middle at her grandmother's misplaced faith, and she was thankful for the absence of the platitudes that had so often been foisted on her over the past few weeks. She could go 100 years without hearing the words, "Everything happens for a reason," or "Time will heal, and it would be too soon." Nan squeezed Sarah's shoulders as the corners of her eyes crinkled.
"I'm so glad you're home."
Sarah sure hoped it could be home again. She picked at a broken thumbnail, suddenly feeling like the empty-handed prodigal. "Any chance you're hiring?" A breathy laugh slipped out of her. Nan nodded, peering over Sarah's shoulder at the storefront. She focused on Sarah's face with a look in her eyes that Sarah could only describe as fierce understanding.
"There's always a place for you here. Always. Let's go inside and see what we can get into."
Nan pushed open the front door. The clank of the miniature cowbells against the glass was a welcome home chorus. But as Sarah stepped over the threshold, the swell of comfort dissolved. The bare spaces on the shelves gaped like holes in a once-perfect smile. Where was the bustle? The hum of gossip and banter that brought the store to life? Sarah walked slowly, the floorboards emitting a plaintive groan beneath her feet.
What's going on? Did a delivery get delayed?
Nan sighed and waved her hand dismissively.
"We're going through a bit of a slump. Not to worry. These things happen. When you've been around as long as I have, you'll see. Hard times are just seasons. They come and go, but we stay. Old Depot Grocery always stays."
We stay? Was that an accusation? But no, Nan was looking over the dead quiet store with a determination that stirred something to life in Sarah's chest. Nan propped her hands on her hips.
"Now that you're here, you can help me convince Rosemary that Old Depot isn't going to go down without a fight."
Mom wanted to close the store? Was that what she wanted to talk about this morning? Sarah had figured Mom had been about to give another reminder of how she'd worked that store her whole life to make sure Sarah never had to.
But Mom's claim that she'd never had opportunities beyond Brighton had never held water, in Sarah's opinion. Mom's sister Jessie was well-traveled, educated, and seemed anything but stuck. Still, Sarah couldn't deny that both her parents worked hard to make sure she could have any life she wanted. Since graduating high school, Sarah had flown far from this little town and seen some of the most stunning views in the world. But there was only one spot on the map she craved, one where she could look into Nan's eyes and absorb her enduring strength and southern sass. Sarah followed Nan to the stockroom.
All right, honey, if you could organize these dry goods by expiration date, it'll help us know what we ought to put on sale next. We've gotten a little behind.
The barrenness in the room felt bigger than a little slump.
Are you and Mom the only ones working here?
Nan sighed and spoke over her shoulder as she exited the room.
Yes, we're at this strange place where just the two of us feels like too many working here and not enough all at the same time.
Maybe the three of them was just what they needed. Nan left Sarah to sort product in the quiet room, and her mind wandered, taking her back to the place she'd fled. To another dimly lit room, this one full of finery instead of dusty canned goods. Takeout Sarah ordered from the restaurant where she and Aaron had their first date had sat between them. Flickering light from the tapers glinted off the facets in the crystal candelabra. Aaron hadn't taken two bites before the phone rang. The warmth that had been building in her middle shrank away, leaving a chill in its place.
I'll be there in 10.
He stood, wiping his face with his napkin, and then offered her a sheepish grin.
It shouldn't take too long. I'll be right back, and then we can celebrate our anniversary in style. No more interruptions.
She couldn't force herself to return the smile. Can't someone else take care of this?
Someday I won't have to be so hands-on. We'll make up for every missed moment, I promise.
Sarah shoved the two-week-old memory away and fled the stockroom. Surely a customer had wandered in by now. She snatched an apron off the hook by the office, slipped it over her head, and tied the waist as she walked. With the Kelly green canvas beneath her touch, a pressure release valve opened, and she took a solid breath. As promised, Mom arrived just after noon. She stood from her car, chewing her bottom lip and massaging her hands. Sarah watched as her mother blew out a puff of air, then fixed a serene expression on her face as she approached the front door. Mom waved a greeting on her way in and walked back to the office. Sarah finished totaling Mrs. Warner's order and helped carry her bags out to her car. She watched her drive away with a sigh of relief. Even here in Brighton, a world so far removed from her life in Kenilworth, a suburb just north of Chicago, there were ripples of concern, or rather pity, for Sarah's situation. But at least here, no one knew Aaron. How long until she could chat about the weather and the latest town gossip without an "I'm so sorry" tacked on? Words that left her fumbling for a response, forcing her to take yet another swim in her pool of regret. She returned to her post at the checkout counter and eased onto the stool.
"Sarah, come here, please,"
her mother called out from the back of the store. Sarah gave a quick look around. The brief rush seemed to have ended. She sighed as she walked along the near-empty produce section. She passed a stray shopping cart, a buggy here in the South. Her New England-raised husband had laughed the first time he heard her call it that. Sarah shook away the thought. The memories weren't supposed to be so fresh and raw in this place she and Aaron never shared other than one brief visit. But they kept creeping in, vivid snapshots of both the good and the ugly. Her mother stood beside the deli counter at the back of the store and extended a paper plate loaded with a ham sandwich and potato salad toward her.
"Here, you look like you could use some lunch.
I'll take over up front. Where's your grandmother, anyway? Sarah accepted the plate, inwardly shuddering. She normally loved her mother's potato salad, but at the moment, the combination of mustard and mayonnaise assaulted her sense of smell. I don't know. She said something about needing to see a man about a goat. Mom did a double take.
A what? What is she up to?
Sarah grinned.
I have no idea.
She set her untouched lunch on the counter, dropping the smile from her face.
Mom, why is the store like this? Nan said it was just a little slump, but it's so empty.
Her mother flinched. The store... She sighed.
Time and life are marching on, and this old place just can't keep up. Your grandmother refuses to see truth. Pray for me, because I'm fixing to lose my mind with her sneaking around, putting in orders we can't afford, chasing off land developers who actually want this obsolete stretch of land.
She lifted her hands and let them fall to her sides.
We need to seize the opportunity to make a profit and sell in the store before we miss our chance. If Mama won't say yes, then some other landowner will.
Mom locked eyes with Sarah.
Maybe the two of us together can make her see reason.
Sarah's heart seized in her chest.
You can't just let this place go. Old Depot is her life. There's got to be a way to fix this.
Mom stiffened and crimson splotched her face.
We've been struggling a while now, which you'd know if you'd visited for more than a red-hot minute once a year.
She leveled a look at Sarah that would make a steel beam melt.
Besides, I'm not letting our store die. After a while, you gotta accept the truth and quit beating an already dead horse.
Panic thrashed in Sarah's chest.
You can't close. You can't. Brighton needs Old Depot Grocery.
I need Old Depot Grocery, she thought. Her mother wiped her clean hands on her apron.
No, it doesn't. Not anymore. Didn't you see the new construction on the way in? A big chain grocery opened 2 weeks ago. There's no coming back from this. We'll just waste our energy better spent on other things.
She let out a long, slow breath.
Just help me convince her, Sarah. She's 75. She'll run herself into the ground trying to make this place survive. She deserves to retire. See a little bit of the world before...
I don't need to see the world. This is my world.
Sarah and her mother spun to the strident voice at the end of the aisle. Nan stood, hands on her wide hips.
We can't lay down and let that big box store steal our heritage. I've worked this store for 56 years, and I'd work it 56 more if the good Lord gave me the wherewithal.
Mama. The words left Mom's lips as a defeated sigh. Sarah, tell her. Maybe she'll listen to her granddaughter with the fancy college degree, since she finds me to be so woefully inept. Sarah glanced between the women, both leveling looks that left her feeling like a favorite toy tugged between two warring children. The cowbells clanked against the glass at the front door.
Oh, look, we have a customer.
Sarah scurried away, winding through the labyrinth of aisles. Aisles she could navigate blindfolded. Whispered bickering sounded behind her back. This was not the homecoming she'd been counting on. Chapter 4. December, 1965.
This baby is getting so big, Jimmy. Must take after you with those long legs kicking around in there.
Glorianne brushed a trickle of sweat from her brow with her shoulder. With a groan, she shifted, cradling her ever-growing abdomen for support. She moved from crouching to sitting at the shelf she restocked with cans of chicken soup. She looked up into Jimmy's eyes and at his mop of blonde curls that had a tendency to resist his attempts to slick it back, no matter how strong the hair gel. He leaned against the aisle, smiling that dimpled smile of his. Her heart did a flip, just like it did every time she laid eyes on him. Then her gaze went to a scar on his index finger, just above the knuckle closest to his hand, a reminder of a childhood farming accident. The doctors had said it was a miracle they were able to save that finger. That miracle likely signed his death warrant. People were considered unfit for service for a myriad of reasons. Surely a missing trigger finger would have sufficed. Glorianne pulled her polyester shirt away from where it was plastered to her, trying to get a little airflow across her sticky skin.
I know you said beauty could be found anywhere if you looked hard enough, but you were wrong. Ain't nothing beautiful about a big, round, sweaty, pregnant woman stacking cans on this dusty bottom shelf. She huffed.
Glorianne, did someone come in? I didn't hear the bells.
Clarence's voice cut into her daydream. The light in Jimmy's expression faded, replaced by a sadness that twisted Glorianne's heart. She glanced over her shoulder to the approaching footsteps.
We'll talk again soon.
Jimmy gave a single nod and turned away.
Glorianne, was someone here?
Clarence stumped toward her in his loud, flat-footed stride. He stopped at her side, arms crossed over his green apron.
Honey, what are you doing on the floor? Mabel was supposed to restock. You shouldn't be doing this in your condition.
Her insides squirmed at his use of a pet name.
I'm not an invalid. It needed doing, and Mabel had to leave early. The school nurse called, and her littlest one is running a fever.
Come on now, I could have done this if you'd mentioned it.
He held out his hand and offered a pained smile.
Let's get you up from there.
She ignored his help and made a less than graceful shift into a crouch and used a shelf to brace herself to standing. She brushed off her hands and straightened her green apron that was twisted across her basketball belly.
No trouble. I was bored out of my mind.
Clarence reached toward her. When she recognized his intention, she stepped back and swiped at the hair stuck to her forehead.
Are you okay, Glorianne?
Of course.
She propped her hands on her hips. Clarence glanced away toward the front of the store, as if trying to make sure no one approached the entrance.
I hear you, you know, talking to him.
Glorianne clenched her hands so tight her nails bit into her palms.
Talking to who?
Maybe it was hateful, making her husband say the name of the man she loved, but she couldn't help but feel like he'd just tread all over something sacred with his big, clumsy feet. Clarence stared at the floor, the paws stretching between them. He lifted his gaze and a muscle ticked in his jaw.
Jimmy,
he said softly. Glorianne blinked back sudden tears, wholly unprepared for the stab she'd taken to her heart when Jimmy's name came off of Clarence's lips.
I know everyone grieves in their own way, but the way you talk to him, I'm not sure it's healthy.
Clarence's brow wrinkled up like a walnut shell, and he looked away.
You talk to him like he's right there next to you.
She gazed out the storefront windows. Jimmy was right there next to her. Gathering up all the scattered pieces of her heart, holding them tight so she didn't fall apart. Sometimes, if she concentrated hard enough, instead of walking these aisles, they walked side by side down the long rows of corn at his grandfather's farm that Jimmy had been so proud of. That was supposed to be her life, and that version was far more real to her than anything in front of her. Clarence stepped to her and put a hand on her shoulder. She shrank from his tender touch.
I think you need to find someone you can talk to about this. Someone real. It's just, you're about to have a baby. And you've already been through so much. It's like you're still stuck somewhere else with someone else, not healing at all. I know you don't see me as a husband, and I don't pretend that you ever will, but I hope you can at least see me as a friend who cares about you, Glorianne. I'm worried.
He gave her shoulder a pat and scooped up the empty cardboard box now delivered of all its cans of soup. She blinked her dry eyes in response to his retreat. Strange how her chest could feel like it had been sliced open in one moment and empty and vacant the next. Maybe she sounded crazy, carrying on conversations with a dead man. What Clarence didn't know was that those conversations with Jimmy kept her from losing her grip on the last thread of her sanity. Far easier to think on what her life should have been than to face the reality of what it was, what it would always be. Forever bound to a man she could not love.
Dear Jimmy, our baby girl came into the world with a feather dusting of snow on the ground and Christmas music crackling from the radio. Not that anyone could hear it over my screaming and crying. Don't tell anyone I said so, but she looks like a grumpy old man. Stark bald, wrinkled, and red-faced. I miss her being inside of me. Somehow it made you closer to me. Over the past few weeks, I've caught Clarence looking at me, peering over the store aisles, his brow creased in concern like I'm about to drop off the deep end any minute. Maybe I am. The nurse keeps asking me if I'd like her to bring my husband to my hospital room. I asked for this pen and paper instead. Is there something wrong with me that I find more comfort in a memory than a flesh and blood person? Maybe. But the fact remains that the one I gave my heart to is too far away to be called. Even by me, it now seems. It shakes me inside, Jimmy, the way I can't feel your nearness. I've tried to see you here with me, kicked back in the burnt orange chair beside me, proud as a peacock of our baby girl. But it stays empty. By and by, will I forget the dreamy spark of your eyes? Will the sweet hayfield scent of your hair fade away too? Or will you come back to me? Please, Jimmy, come back to me just once more so that I can pretend that you and I are together, beholden this child we made. I wouldn't tell this to anybody else, but I wished for a boy. I would have called him Jimmy no matter what anyone said. You remember that book of flower meanings you loved? I found a copy of it at the library. I'll find our girl's name in those pages. No surprise, but Mother didn't come. I know I shouldn't have hoped. She hasn't visited once since I moved here, not even for the baby shower the church in Brighton hosted for me. I gave birth to our baby all alone in a stark white room with the nurse holding my hand. I can't send letters to heaven, I know that. And I know the images of you were only makings of my lonely heart. But if somehow you can hear from heaven, I want you to know that I'll be all right. I don't love Clarence, but he is kind, and he doesn't expect much. I guess it's gratitude, this feeling I have for him. Your daughter will grow up taken care of, Jimmy. And I'll find a way to be okay. To find the beauty you always saw in this drab world. Always yours, Glorianne. Chapter 5. Present Day. Summoned by the clank of bells, Sarah hurried to the front of the store. Mom and Nan's hushed bickering provided the ambiance of the empty grocery. Their fussing had been her constant companion for the past week.
A tall, lanky man stood by the register with his back to her in worn-in jeans and work boots. The battered cowboy hat he absently tapped against his leg looked like it had been a casualty of a cattle stampede. A crate of vegetables sat at his feet.
"Welcome to Old Depot Grocery. Is there something I can help you with?" she asked.
He turned, his blue-green eyes a shock against his suntanned skin.
"Afternoon, ma'am."
She soaked in the comfort she found in his slow, easy southern drawl.
"I know your manager said the other day she didn't need any further orders, but I had a little bit left over from my stand today. Thought y'all could sell 'em. No charge or anything."
"My manager?"
Sarah blinked, trying to follow the conversation.
"Miss Rosemary?"
A snort slipped out of her. Manager might be one way to describe her relationship with her mother. A question formed in his eyes.
"Rosemary is my mother. I'm her daughter, Sarah."
A friendly smile took over his face.
"Hello, Sarah. I'm Clay. Here for visit?"
Sarah shrugged and smiled.
"I'm here for, well, I'm here for now."
He glanced at her apron.
"They didn't waste any time putting you to work, I see."
"Nan always said that idle hands were the devil's playthings."
Clay gave a nod, but something guarded flickered over his expression.
"Wise woman."
"That she is."
He lifted the crate of vegetables and stepped toward the produce section. The volume of Nan and Mom's voices escalated. Sarah winced.
"Just leave them there on the counter, if you don't mind. I'll see to them."
She offered a sheepish smile.
"Please, I need any excuse I can get to look busy and stay out of their henpecking."
A corner of his mouth twitched, and he placed the crate on the edge of the checkout counter. He set his battered hat atop his head.
"Have a good day, Sarah."
He raised his gaze toward the back of the store where her mother's and grandmother's bickering sounded.
"Give Miss Rosemary and Miss Gloria Ann my best."
The man tipped his hat and exited the store. Sarah reined in her grin at his gesture. Tipped hats and ma'ams and misses. She was definitely back in the South again. She hefted the heaping crate of vegetables he'd left behind and stocked the bare places. When the task was complete, she admired the contrast between the vine-ripened tomatoes, zucchini, and crookneck squash. Old Depot Grocery no longer looked so forlorn and forsaken with fresh produce filling the shelves. As long as she ignored the other sparse aisles at her back, her mother and grandmother strode toward her, still carrying on about spreadsheets and orders and the fate of the town. Her mother stopped short with a sharp gesture directed toward the produce display.
"What's this? Mama, I told you we weren't taking any more produce orders. I had to throw half the last one out."
Nan propped her hands on her hips.
"I didn't. I left that to you, which was obviously a huge mistake."
Sarah cleared her throat.
"A man named Clay dropped them off. He said it was leftovers."
Nan's face softened.
"You met Clay? He's a fine young man."
Mom rolled her eyes skyward.
"A little soft in the head, if you ask me, giving us his vegetables to sell for free. Those don't look like leftovers to me."
"Don't mind your mama, Sarah. She's in one of her moods. Clay's just being kind."
Nan wriggled her eyebrows.
"He's a looker, ain't he?"
Sarah grinned. Was that a faint blush coloring her grandmother's cheeks?
"Sounds like somebody's got a crush."
Nan wagged her finger playfully.
"I'm far too old for such foolishness, but I can't help it if he's a little sweet on me."
Sarah laughed at Nan's teasing words. Nan tilted her head.
"You ought to get to know him, Sarah. You'd like him.
For heaven's sake, Mama, her husband's not even cold in the grave. She's grieving, not looking to make eyes at Clay Watson. Nan huffed. That's not what I meant.
Sarah's ears began to buzz, and her chest grew tight. Grieve. A good wife would grieve, but she just wanted to forget. Her stomach churned. Sarah clapped her hand over her mouth and rushed to the back door lest she empty her stomach on the waxed wood aisles. Rosemary walked down the sidewalk in the town square, rubbing a hand over her face, as if it could scrub out the horrified way Sarah and Mama looked at her whenever she mentioned that the store needed to close, like she held a dripping knife, fresh from stabbing them both in the back. Mama, she understood. But Sarah? Her daughter hadn't batted an eye at that store since she'd moved out 12 years ago. She huffed. She'd spent her life fighting for that store. Did Sarah and Mama truly have no idea how hard she'd worked through recessions? The many times the store had been on the brink of failing and she'd worked herself to the bone to pull it back from the edge. The never-ending tension between the cost of doing business and the needs of the community. Hey there, Rosemary. Rosemary raised a hand and waved to Carl across the street. He was locking up at the hardware store that had been the centerpiece of the town square for years. A yellow closeout banner spanned the front window. Old man Benton had spent his last days trying to keep his store going, working up until the day he died. She wouldn't let that happen to her mother. If they went ahead and sold the store to the development company while they were eager to make a deal, they would both be able to tuck away a tidy sum, at least enough to make sure Mama was well cared for and create a savings account to help with her own uncertain future. She loosened and tightened her hands, trying to fend off the tingling in her fingertips. Rosemary had taken it upon her shoulders at the tender age of 17 to make sure her mother was provided for. If the store sold, she could finally count her mission as complete. She slipped into the travel agency in a little historic home on the outskirts of the main square and plopped onto the couch with a groan, freeing her swollen feet from her kids. High heels clicked on the hardwood.
Girl, just wait until you see the cruise package I've got picked out. Even your stick-in-the-mud husband is gonna love it.
Kathy, her lifelong friend, stepped out of her office with a file as thick as her tiny waist, a file full of dreams the two of them had been working on for over a year. Ever since Rosemary had gotten wind of the big grocery chain coming to town, dreams that had become further expedited after her diagnosis. With her cut from the store's sale, she'd make one little splurge for her and Beau to make up for all the trips they'd never taken, and then the rest would go into a health savings account. Rosemary held up a hand.
Might as well stuff it away in the back of your filing cabinet. Mama's going to keep at that floundering store until she's racked up enough debt to drain every bit of equity out of it.
Kathy perched her bird-like frame on the edge of the couch and put a hand on Rosemary's shoulder.
Besides, Rosemary said, you and I both know Beau was never going to agree to this trip. He calls himself a fisherman, but he's scared to death of being on the water.
We could always make it a girls' trip, me and you. Some yellow polka dot bikinis.
Kathy bumped shoulders with her. Rosemary choked back a laugh at the mental image. Kathy could probably get away with such a thing, even at their age. But Rosemary had more curves than any bikini could contain with any amount of decency. She shook her head.
Mama's not going to sell. And if we don't, I don't see how we'll manage the bills, much less a dream vacation.
It's all gonna work out. You'll see.
Rosemary stood and paced the narrow foyer.
You haven't seen the way Mama and Sarah look at me,
like I'm about to head out back and shoot old Yeller.
I'm so glad Sarah came home. I know she said she didn't want to trouble you with driving all that way to go to the funeral, but a girl needs her mother in times like these.
Rosemary sat back down. Didn't want to trouble her? More like Sarah didn't want to be embarrassed, again, by her hillbilly relations. Rosemary knew that she and Beau had stuck out like a couple of sore thumbs at Sarah's elegant wedding.
She's here for a quick visit. Can you believe my mother was trying to rope Sarah over to her side? Sarah's not the one trying to eke out a living here. Sure, she is sentimental about the place, but Mama and I can't afford sentimentality.
Kathy plopped the file onto the couch next to Rosemary.
Trust me. Glory Ann is going to see reason, and you are going to get the chance to take that dream trip and all the other things you've been putting on hold for all these years.
Her hands flicked and fluttered while she spoke.
Rosemary grinned. The woman wouldn't be able to speak if she was forced to sit on her hands.
What I don't understand is why you don't just tell them the truth.
One hand on her hip, Kathy shook a finger in Rosemary's direction.
If they knew the real reason you're so eager to sell, they'd change their tune. Take a page out of your sister's book and take care of yourself for once.
Rosemary sighed. It was so much more complicated than that. She'd tell Sarah about her health problems, but not until Sarah got herself resettled and moved forward with her own life. After all Rosemary had done to make sure her daughter never made life choices based on obligation, she couldn't fail now. Rosemary forced a smile and grabbed the bulging folder next to her.
You're right. It'll work out, one way or another. Might as well dream a few minutes longer.
Kathy passed her a tin from the side table.
I made some chocolate-covered pretzels last night. Your favorite.
Well, fork those over, sister. I sure as shootin' need some chocolate therapy this afternoon.
Chapter 6. March, 1967. Glory Ann scooped her daughter from the back seat, relishing the sweet pudge still lingering on the 15-month-old's lengthening legs. The curly-haired tot pushed back from her mother's embrace and bore her blue-eyed gaze into Glory Ann's.
Down! Me do it!
Glory Ann swiped a thumb across the child's sticky cheek.
Okay, but stay close and no running. It's Grandma Hawthorne's birthday.
Her chest tightened.
And we must be on our very, very best behavior.
Glory Ann put her daughter down and straightened the crumpled flounces of the tiny pink dress. She then smoothed the front of her own orange shift.
Now, hold my hand.
It had been months since she'd been home to see her parents, and though her mother promised she'd come to Brighton, she had never made the one-hour drive. Not in the many months her little one grew in her middle. Not when she'd labored in the sterile hospital, longing for her mother's hand to hold, nor any other time during the 15 months of her daughter's life. She took a shaking breath and found an anchor in her child's tight grip on her thumb. It had seemed a fun idea to surprise Mother on her birthday, but with all the cars filling the driveway, it appeared she was a gatecrasher. Not even an invited guest to the only place that felt like home.
Come along, love.
Glory Ann steadied her daughter as she toddled up the porch stairs. She didn't bother knocking, the buzz of conversation inside pulling her onward. All went quiet before a chorus of happy birthday rose. Glory Ann scooped up her daughter, and together they entered the dimmed room but stayed outside the circle of familiar faces gathered around the kitchen table. The glow of birthday candles softened the lines on her mother's face, making her appear years younger than Glory Ann ever remembered. Something in her middle twisted. and she fought back swelling emotion she couldn't name. The song ended and the room silenced as the company waited for her mother to blow out her candles. In the silence, the tiny girl in Glorianne's arms burst forth an exuberant,
"Happy birthday, Gamma!"
Collectively, the room shifted in their direction, and Glorianne shrank back. A gasp sounded to her left. Jimmy's mother stood with her hand pressed against her chest, staring at the child. Glorianne swallowed. Jimmy's daughter. Surely Mrs. Woodston didn't recognize. Her father appeared at her elbow and steered her from the room just as her mother blew out the candles. He spoke.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.